Yeah, so last class we discussed about what do we understand by information, what do we understand by data, why it is required to store information, and what are the different information corpuses we have. Okay, so and how information can be represented? Information can be represented in terms of categories. Like if you talk about Amazon.com, here the information regarding a particular product, they have different categories like books, fashion, pantry, and so on and so forth. In books also they have different categories. Okay, so it provides me the information like all these books which are present in a particular category. Suppose they are biographies, okay? Educational books, course books, engineering books. So all these categories, maybe I don't know about all the books which are there in a particular category, but since it's organized in that category, it is stored in that category, it gives me some information. Okay, it may be related to engineering courses. Okay, similarly, information can be represented in form of equation. It provides me the relation between multiple variables and what is happening. Okay, neural network. Now, neural network, what happens in neural network is, just giving you a brief overview, not much detail. So we have input. That input is given to a model, and that gives us output. Okay. Now, what is this model? It can be considered as a mathematical representation. Of information. Now, what is mathematical representation of information? Generally, what happens in neural network is it includes two things: training and testing. It's just a broad overview. It's not applicable for all classes of neural networks. I'm talking about in general. Okay, what happens? So while training, what we provide is, suppose we have multiple fruits. Okay, so you are given with an apple, banana, orange. So what information you will provide to your model? You will provide the, okay, if a fruit is round, it's red in color, it's a smooth texture, very very shiny texture, then it is probably a apple. Second time, orange will come. It also has a round shape. It's orange in color, but it has a rough texture. It's not as smooth as apple. So you can differentiate apple and oranges. Then banana, it has elongated shape. It is yellow in color. Okay. And it also has somewhat smooth surface, but not shiny. Now, when So this model has represented this information mathematically while training. We provide instances, we provide these features, and we also say if these are the features, it learns the relationship. Like if these are the attributes, I can say like shape, color, texture, then it is a apple. Otherwise, it's orange or banana or whatever is the case. Now, so this model has been trained. Now, this model represents this information. Okay. Now, whenever I suppose I provide a green apple, so it checks like in which category it can put this green apple. It's also round in shape, it's not elongated in shape, so it can't be banana. It's round in shape, so it can be orange or it can be apple. Now, since it is neither red, it's nor orange in color, therefore it will look for other attributes. What are other attributes? That it has smooth texture, it has shiny texture. So probably more likely it would be a apple than orange. Okay, so this information was present in this model. Okay, and therefore we can get the desired output. Is this clear? Similarly, we have logical statements. Logical statements also represent some kind of information, that if this follows this logic, like A is related to B, B is related to C, then A is also related to A is related to B, B is related to C, then A is also related to C. These kind of logics. So it gives us some information regarding the relationship of different objects. Similarly, information can be represented in terms of images. Okay, it can provide me how many people have, like if I take this screenshot, so how many people are really coming on a regular basis in my class. So this gives me some information about the attendance. Okay, so yeah, these are the ways to represent information. Do you find any other way which I have missed?
Graphs.
Maps, very good. Charts, graphs, very good. So these also provide us certain kind of information. The best example is your Google map, which provides the information about traffic, which provides the information about the distance, how much time is left, by what time you will reach your destination. And these are things are also other ways to represent information. Now, we have talked about type of information. We have talked about how these are represented, but how they can be captured. Okay, so we have seen that information can be captured both manually and digitally. Okay, and there are some automatic ways as well where this information which is being captured, which is collected, can be converted digitally automatically. Okay, and this information, like what information which we are captured, depends upon the needs of the organization. Okay, like in our MIA system, we are capturing the marks of each student, and then we want to know about the performance of each student. So that is the application which is there for as an academic institute. Okay, if it's suppose a software company, then it could be like different kind of information which they want to capture. Now, these are some of the ways. It's not very comprehensive list, but these are some of the ways by which information can be captured. So there are manual ways, like you can get those forms filled where the information is written about, like, name, age, occupation, qualifications, all these things. So this is the manual way. Even when you prepare your CV in your PDF document, it is like manual way of capturing information. In MIS, if I'm putting the marks, if faculty is putting the marks, it is like manual way of capturing. It's not completely manual, it's a combination of manual and automatic. Entering marks is manual, but then calculating of grades and performance and other things are automatic. Okay, so it can be a combination of both as well. Now let's talk about automatic methods. One is optical character recognition. Now what happens is, what is optical character recognition? It converts the text. Suppose I have taken the screenshot of a slide, okay, in which it is written introduction to IDBMS. You all can try this out right now. Take a screenshot of any slide, information capture. Suppose you capture this slide. Take a screenshot of it. Now, will you be able to select methods of information capture from this image? Yes or no?
No, ma'am.
Try it yourself, okay? So yes, you will not be able to search, and if you want to, suppose you have taken so many screenshots. Suppose for all my lectures, you have taken screenshots of some important slides. Now, all these images are in your gallery now. When you can select these sentences or words, will you be able to search it on the basis of the text which is written here? Yes or no?
No.
It doesn't know, no? It just consider it as an image which has some information, which has some, it could be anything for it. Now, so this image, this screenshot, if you put it in a OCR, some of the OCRs which are freely available, one of this is Tesseract. It's by Google. Okay. What it will do is, if it does not contain, if in this particular site, I have like handwritten notations as well. So it may not work in this handwritten case. But if a slide contains only text and images as well, then it will convert this text into, I will call it as digital text. Digital text means that when you now, what if you want to select some information, some sentence, some point, you will be able to do it. Okay, so your Adobe Reader is one of the examples. There are certain books. Earlier, when I was like doing my BTech MTech, at that time, most of the books were scanned PDFs. So we were not able to search or find any chapter from that book. What we used to do is we used to just scroll one by one. Adobe also like matured out of these researches. It designed some of the OCRs which could convert these books into digital text automatically. Even today, there are certain books which are there in the scanned format, but most of the books are searchable and we can do all the editing as well. Not cut, but yeah, we can select, we can copy, okay, these things. So this is done using optical character recognition. It will automatically capture the information. Abhi, if it is an image, it's just a data. Okay. Then by passing it to OCR, it will convert into information. Now let's talk about ICR. It is intelligent character recognition. You can consider this as the advanced version of optical character recognition. Here it is also able to capture the handwritten sentences also. It will be able to convert your handwritten notes into digital format. I don't know if most of you have used this application or not. In Play Store also, these days some information is present. When you will write something on your mobile phones, even if I'm using iPad, if I'm writing something in my handwriting and I want to convert it into digital text, it will do it. So this is like intelligent character recognition. One example of intelligent character recognition. Optical mark reader, OMR. I should not explain this much because you all have used OMR sheets while giving your JE exams. Okay, you fill the circles corresponding to the correct answer, correct option. Okay, now, many people give JEE exam. like 2 or 3 lakhs or 5 lakhs people students give JEE exam. And results we have to declare very soon, quickly. So if we will do it manually, then there would be a human error, and we all know that in points if there is a change in percentile, the student may suffer. Okay, so there is optical mark reader, which will like read all the circles which are dark and will prepare the results automatically. So automatically information is captured. MICR, if you will see your bank checks at the bottom, there is MICR code. Okay, so this MICR code is read automatically by these readers, and they keep track of the amount deducted or deposited with respect to a particular check, bank check. So it is widely used in banking industry. Smart cards, like in metro, if you want to
excuse me ma'am,
yes,
can you please repeat MICR?
So MICR, if you will see your checkbook, no, so there is a MICR code at the bottom of it, just notice it. Okay, so what happens is keeping a track of all the check might be difficult, and it may like some information, some human error could be created. In MICR code, what happens is it automatically keep tracks of, suppose that check was used to withdraw some amount from a particular account. So it will keep track of like from whose account and what amount was deducted on what date. So this information is captured automatically using this MICR code. Is it okay, Athar?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Smart cards, when you travel, I don't know, in Jaipur, when you will come, we have like metros here. In Delhi also, and in other parts of the country where you have metros, where there are smart cards. Smart cards, like, and from which station you are, you just show the smart card at the time of entry and exit. An amount is deducted automatically, like how much distance you have traveled, how much stations you have traveled. Okay, so this information so you can recharge it automatically, amount will be deducted on the basis of your destination. And later on, if you want, like which person has a particular smart card, has like visited what metro stations, which metro stations. So this information can be obtained using smart cards. Another example of smart cards is your credit cards these days. Like if your transaction amount is below 2000, you will just tap it and automatically that amount will be deducted. And it also captures certain information like where this amount was deducted and date, time, etc. But the best example of smart cards is used in your metros. Now, web data capture, it's like on websites, if you visit some websites, it tells you like how many visitors have already visited the website, and it increases the website count. It also checks what are the links which were clicked on a particular website. If you want to get idea of this, you can just see Google Analytics. It provides all these details, and all these details are very important. Why? Because suppose I want to put ad on a particular website, I want to know how many people visit this website, at what duration these traffic is increased. Okay, so, and what are the keywords which they have used to come to this particular website. So all this information has to be captured, and which will take which will be used to take future course of action. Similarly, voice recognition, if you have used Google Meet these days, it can like remove all the background noises, and it will only consider the most prominent, the dominant noise. Okay, so noise can be reduced and the communication is much better. Similarly, voice recognitions can be also used as a security system. Suppose my security system will only recognize my voice, and then only it will operate. So these are the voice recognition systems similar to your fingerprint recognition or face recognition systems. Is this okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Now, this information processing, like how once we have represented information, how what things can be done on this particular information? The first is that I want to retrieve, that I want to search a particular information. The second is I want to, if image is there and we have already, it's a data, then we have applied some processing and we were able to identify how many people and what people are there. So this help us in also recognition and inference, like, you know, if there is an image, there is automatic image captioning, like what this image is representing. It's an image, if it's like contains some people, two people, or multiple people having a pitch kind of setting, wickets are there. So it will say that this image represents people playing cricket. Okay. So like this is, this processing can be done on the information which has been, or data which has been represented. Now, in how do we access this information? So we can access this information while searching. We all know how to search. We can go on Google. You can use Control S command to search for any file or any particular sentence. Then we have links, like we can go from one link to another link. Instead of putting everything in one document, sometimes links are there. That means if you want to go for, you are interested in knowing more about a particular topic, then you can visit a link, okay, and get the information regarding. The most common example is your Wikipedia. It gives a definition of a particular topic, and then it provides a link of some key, some words. So you can go, you can use that link, hyperlink, and visit the next page which contains detailed information about that particular topic. Links are also your URL links that you can directly visit. Instead of using hyperlinks, you can directly use URLs for getting some information. Then browsing, navigation, going from one link to another, navigating from one link to another. It's all different methods for information access. Now, similar to in the last class, we talked about database and database system. Okay. Similarly, we have information systems, or we have information management system, which help us in collection, from where we are collecting the data, how we are representing and organize that information, how we are storing that information, and if we want to communicate that information to someone else, then how we are doing it. So a system which does all these things are included in information system. Now this information system can be manual, like you might not be knowing, but earlier library management system, we used to have like cards, or even now, if you will go to the librarian and ask for a particular book, he tells you this number, okay? In LMIT, when you will come, so it tells like on which rack you have to go and in which shelf that book is should be present. So it's like manually maintaining and manually searching for that information. Though we have automatic library system as well, but it's a combination of both. Okay. So, and other is like capturing, like recording and putting numbers in all the books manually, and then keeping, organizing it manually. Then searching could be automatic. Okay. So it can be a combination of manual or automatic processes. Some of the library systems, like information systems, we have already seen libraries, databases, web. It's a huge source of information, and it is maintaining these information in a very, very systematic manner. Okay, if you will see Google search engine, you will notice that the information that you want, only the relevant information is retrieved, not the complete information. Or the irrelevant information. Okay. So, yeah. So, what are the constituents of any information system? Let's talk about it. It's just a definition. So, the components of information systems are hardware. This is an important component. Like these are computer equipments which are used to perform input, processing, storage, and output activities. Okay, then we have, these are like information system, but I can more appropriately, I can call it as computer based information system. I'm talking about the computer based information system, CBIS. Okay, so we have hardware, computer equipments which are used to perform input, processing, storage, and output activities. We have softwares that governs the operation of the computer. And what kind of softwares we have? First class of computer programming. Types of softwares. Anyone who remembers what is?
Applications and operating systems.
Application software and system software. Very good. So we have system softwares. These system software directly interacts with your hardware, and we have application software which interacts with the user and maintain a link between system software and the end user. So the system software example Akash has given, or Sridhar, I don't remember. So it's like your operating system is an example of system software. Your compilers, all these are examples of your system software. And application softwares are also there. Okay. So like your Word, your Google Meet, which we are using right now, all these are examples of your application software. Then we have database, that is organized collection of, it's not just data, it's data or information. Or more appropriately, I can call it as a database, which is like organized collection of facts and information consisting of multiple data files, may or may not consist of multiple data files, and it depends on the application of a particular organization. Then we have networks, like we connecting computers and equipment to enable electronic communication. Even if it's a, it can be a local connection by which different computers are connected so that in a particular area, information can be exchanged between those systems. It can be connecting it to a wider network like your broadband internet services so that electronically we can communicate. Then we have like procedures and people. So these procedures includes the strategies, policies, methods, and rules for using the computer-based information system. Now, like how it can be used. Okay, there are system there is a software, hardware, that's fine, but we have to define certain rules like procedures, how this has to be done. Then the people, that's the most important element in most of the computer based information system. Okay, because even if you talk about MIS or your course registration form, then a person is required to maintain it, to keep the backup of your files. So if even if your system gets crashed, there are backup files, there are log files. If there is an error, so he or she can analyze that, analyze log files and identify the error. If some updations are required, so people, yeah, it's a most one of the most important component of your information systems. Okay. Now there are different types of information systems on the basis of the organization, like where it is used. So this executive support system, this is used by like the senior management people to make these strategies. It contains the information about like profit, loss, overall sales report, marketing report, and these kind of information. Okay, it also keeps track of the performance of different employees at different scales. Okay, so further course of decisions can be taken. And MIS, Management Information System. What is this? We have all have used this. So, you know, it's like collection of people, procedures, software, databases, and devices that provides routine information to, I can say, if we talk about LNMIT, it can provide routine information to faculty members and to deans, so that appropriate decisions can be taken to improve the quality of teaching. If you talk about any particular organization, another organization, then it will provide the routine information to managers and other decision makers. Okay, like marketing, production, other things, routine information. Similarly, we have like a decision support system which are specifically designed for a particular decision. Like it says application specific, like if there are some cases of uncertainties, it will help the management to take a appropriate decision. And similarly, knowledge-based system, which can be considered as like people share their experiences as well, their knowledge as well. The one example, I don't know, you people have used is Slack. In Slack, you can send messages, and that is also, it's okay. But people use this platform to exchange ideas as well, to share notes, to share, to keep track of any project. So this is like knowledge management system. It is one step higher to knowledge is, you can say, one step higher to your information. You have data, from data you get information, and with experience you have some knowledge out of this information, knowledge out of I can say information. So yeah. Now these transaction processing systems, these are generally used in, widely used in banking systems. What do we understand by transaction? Let's understand this first. So transaction is any exchange, business related exchange, such as payment to employees, sales to customers. So these are considered as transaction. Okay, in banking industries, like you withdraw some amount, you deposit some amount. So any modification in your database is can be considered as your transaction. Okay, so these are like, if for routine transaction, we have this system, which are called as transaction management system. And office automation, like library automation, to keep track of when a particular employee is coming, when he is going, what are the tasks, like with, is the employee meeting the given deadlines, how is the performance, and so on and so forth. So this is what, which this is like information management system, which we have already discussed, that it manages information, analyzes and derive knowledge out of it to take further course of action. Now let's talk about this important concept, navigation, query and declarative query. Like we have this database, we have this database management system which contains information as well as facts, that is data. Okay, now if we want to search for some information, we have to access this database, and what we call this a request to access database, we call this as query. That is, we fire a query to get some particular information or to access a data from database. So that query can be fired to manipulate some information. Suppose I withdraw some amount from my bank account, then the query would be to request, like it will give me the amount, but it will also update the balance amount in my database. Okay, so any request which is there to access the data from database, it is called as query. Okay, now how this request is made or how this instruction is given to the system that I need some particular information, so on the basis of that, we can divide the queries broadly. We are talking in terms of database management system, okay? Otherwise, there is another classification of categorization of queries as well. So we are talking from a DBMS perspective. So these queries can be of two types, declaration queries and navigational queries. Before coming to the declaration and navigational queries, let's talk about two type of.
Ma'am?
Yes?
Ma'am, can we say the Google search, where we search whatever we need, is also a type of query?
Yes, it's a query.
Okay.
So this query comes from web search perspective. So here also we have different categorization of queries. When we talk about web search, so we have transactional queries, we have navigational queries, we have informative queries. So there we have different categorization. When we talk about database perspective, that is we are searching some information or we are accessing some information from database, then we have these two broad categorization. Okay?
Okay.
So there is different categorization of programming as well. So we write, when we want to interact with computer, we have some programming languages. So when we want to interact with databases using these queries, we also have languages. Okay. So we can say we have, there are different type of programming languages like procedural, object-oriented, declarative, and functional. We are right now focusing on procedural, which is also called as imperative programming. And declarative programming. So declarative programming. Now, what do we understand by procedural programming? So if we want to give some instruction in C language, in C programming language, suppose I want, there is an Amazon parcel outside my house. So I want to like give instruction to my computer that please go and pick that parcel. In C, if I have to give instruction, C or Java or Python, I have to tell the computer, tell the machine all the steps which has to be taken. Like open the door, go outside, pick up that parcel and bring it back to me. Okay. This is like procedural programming. What is declarative programming? It just tells like fetch the parcel. That's all. Single statement. So what we are actually doing is, in procedural programming, we are giving instruction. We are like providing step by step instruction. So we are focusing on how the task has to be done. Okay. In declarative programming, we talk about what task has to be done. That's all. So your C, Java, Python, it comes under the category of procedural programming, imperative programming, in which you tell all these steps and you focus how this task has to be done. In declarative programming, we are just focusing on what task has to be done. So we will talk about SQL, like data which is used to access information from your databases. This is example of the declarative programming. We only focus. One example is, I will just say, select star from student. So it will show all the details of show the contents of the student table, which contains maybe name, roll number, marks, age, branch, this kind of information. If same thing I would have to write in case of C, what I will do? I have to provide the step-by-step instructions, like iterate through rows, iterate through each column, and then print it in a proper format. Okay. So this is the major difference. Now, the databases also can be categorized as multiple types. The one is your relational model. Relational model or database. And another is network database model. In relational database model, what happens is the information, all the related information are stored in form of tables. So if I have a student table, student database, relational database, all the related information will be stored at a particular place, and say a single row will give me the information, all the related information regarding the single student. Then I can have multiple tables as well, which are related to each other. I'm not talking about these things because these things will come as we will learn more about this subject in detail. Okay, so this is the example of your relational database. In network database, we don't represent the information in this manner. We have different entities like customer who will order something. If there is an order entity, there is order line which he wants to order. So product is also related to this order line. Then shipment of this order line is also there. So there is another entity which is also related to it. Okay, so we can say that these entities are represented in form of a network or in form of a graph. Okay, here if we want to fetch a particular information, a particular record, we have to tell the path. So we have to tell the path, like go in this way. If we want to go from product to order line, then go in this way. Okay, which is more convenient for you? So in navigational query, what happens is we instruct the sequence of steps how to reach a required record. Okay, so it is similar to your procedural thing. Okay, why declarative query? It says like how to fetch. While declarative query, it does not tell like what sequence it has to follow. It will just say what it wants. That's all. And these declarative queries are used in relational database models. Earlier, when this database models were started, were designed, were introduced, then these network database models were popular. Okay, so in that we have to provide the complete sequence, like how it should be fetched. But with the advent of relational database model around 1970s or 1980s, these relational database models were introduced. And after that, we don't use these network database models much. But these days, it has come to the notice, like at some around 2000 and late 2000s, there are certain attributes of these network-based models as well. So now some databases which are called as object-oriented databases, they are combination of both these relational models and network models. Otherwise, most of the database models which we use, which we design, have declarative queries. Is this clear? Is this clear, everyone?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Why you think that navigational query or these navigational APIs, what limitations they have? What limitations you think they have?
See, ma'am, if an error comes in one of the steps, then the rest of the steps won't happen.
Yeah, the first thing, apart from this, the first thing in case of navigational query is that you have to provide the complete sequence. That means agar hum network model ki baat kare, then we have to start from this entity, then go to this entity, then go to this entity. If the number of entities are very large, which is the case in real world databases, then debugging or this query becomes not very readable, and it is very difficult to debug. What sequence, where I have missed, whether you have missed, you have directly reached here, so there is no link here. Customer is not directly related to order line. Customer is linked to order line using order entity. Okay, there is no direct link between them. So if you write a query where these links are missing, then it is difficult to debug. The second is, suppose you do some changes in your data structure. Suppose before order line there is some category which has been inserted. Then what will happen? You have to, then whatever queries you have written now, they will be of no use. You have to again write these queries. So these are some of the limitations of these navigational queries, or we can say navigational APIs. Is this okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So this is the last topic related to the introduction of information management system. So there are some quality issues regarding the how good is your information management system primarily depends on these four points. The first point is whether this system is reliable or not. Can anyone tell me what do we understand by reliable? See, if you're in
total uptime, I mean, out of 7 days, how many hours are it, is it really up? I mean, uptime checks that we do.
Yeah. And another thing is whatever information which we are storing, the way we are representing the information, is it correct? Suppose I have a database where I don't have any column with student ID, and I'm storing marks. So I have like two students named Akash Mohan. So now what is, like, if I have stored marks and there is like swapping between these two names, because I don't have any ID field here, then the data which I'm storing is not reliable. And one more thing which is not directly linked with reliability, but can be linked here, is like, what are the measures which we have taken in case of system failure? Suppose my system database crashed. So do I have log file or recovery files already with me? Do I have backup of all the files? Do I have taken the proper provisions for disaster management? Okay. So these are also related to reliability. Then only my system will be reliable. Agar ek bar mein hi system crash ho gaya, and suppose your MIS gets crashed, and next time we lose all the information, then how we will be able to decide the performance, how you will get your final grade, CGPI, everything will be lost. Okay, in that case we can say that this system is not reliable. Okay, so how good the system is in case of these crashes, failures, what are the safety measures, what are the security measures which we have taken, are also included in reliability. Then scalability, this thing we have already discussed in the last class. Can you give me very good example of security which you all have faced while you are booking your vaccine slot? How you book your vaccine slot? Cowin portal?
Yes, ma'am.
Earlier, maybe while we were designing this database for retrieval and other things, we have like not analyzed the scale of usability of this portal. So earlier, as soon as the load increases, this Cowin stopped working. Okay, their calculation may not be correct. But now proper provisions might have taken, like they may have increased extra servers. They have enhanced and improved their load balancers. Okay, due to which now if we access Cowin, everything works very smoothly. So scalability should be a concern, that our database should be able to handle the increased or decreased load without affecting its productivity. Okay, this is the scalability. Efficiency and effectiveness, can anyone tell me the difference? See, efficiency is generally calculated on basis of like least amount of latency period, a least amount of or the optimum use of your resources, whether these resources are in terms of time or money or any other efforts, everything. So if we accomplish something in least amount of efforts and time, then it is efficiency. So your database should be efficient. In banking industry, everything should be in real time. As soon as the amount is deducted, it should be reflected in your account. If there is a gap, even you know, if of milliseconds, then it can create chaos. Similarly, it should be effective. Like whatever task is given to it, it should do it accordingly. It should meet all the goals which are there for designing a particular system. So this is all for today's class. I am sorry I have taken 2 or 3 minutes more. So any doubts, if you have, you can ask. Okay then, see you on Friday.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.